हेलो फ्रेंड्स, आई एम डॉक्टर अवनीश गोयल। आई कंप्लीटेड माय एमडी डर्मेटोलॉजी, वेनेरोलॉजी एंड लेप्रोलॉजी इन द ईयर 2006। सिंस देन आई एम प्रैक्टिसिंग स्किन एंड एजुकेटिंग स्किन एट वेरियस प्लेटफॉर्म्स। I welcome you all to this Unacademy Plus platform, wherein you can have pocket-friendly live interactive sessions from top educators, and you can access them from anywhere in the world. हेलो फ्रेंड्स, हेलो फ्रेंड्स, आई एम डॉक्टर अवनीश गोयल। आई कंप्लीटेड माय एमडी इन डर्मेटोलॉजी, वेनेरोलॉजी एंड लेप्रोलॉजी इन द ईयर 2006। सिंस देन आई एम एजुकेटिंग स्किन एज वेल एज प्रैक्टिसिंग स्किन। आई वेलकम यू ऑल टू दिस अनअकैडमी प्लस प्लेटफॉर्म, वेयर इन यू कैन हैव पॉकेट फ्रेंडली लाइव इंटरेक्टिव सेशंस फ्रॉम टॉप एजुकेटर्स, and you can access them from anywhere in the world. So let us start the today's course. Please wait for some time till this okay, let us start. So I am Dr. Avnish Goyal. I completed my MD in 2006. Since then I am practicing skin. So let us start the multiple choice questions in dermatology. So let us start with the first question. The first question is, a 32 year old male presents with burning micturition, urethral discharge. Smear shows absence of diplococci in macrophages and positive leukocyte esterase test. The likely diagnosis is, so here your choices are gonorrhea, LGV, non-gonococcal urethritis and foreign body. Can anybody tell me what is the correct answer? Yes, the point here to catch is that there is absence of diplococci. There is absence of diplococci in macrophages and positive leukocyte estrus test. So always try to read in between the lines the absence of diplococci. So answer here is non-gonococcal urethritis. Coming to the discussion part, the non-gonococcal urethritis is common in Western world. Though it is common nowadays, the incidence is increasing in India. The causes of non-gonococcal urethritis is Chlamydia D2K, that is the most common. Otherwise, Mycoplasma, Trichomonas vaginalis, Candida species, Adenovirus and Herpes simplex virus, they are associated with non-gonococcal urethritis. The Chlamydia trachomatis being most commonly associated. The incubation period is pretty long as compared to gonococcal urethritis. It varies from 1 week to 6 weeks in non-gonococcal urethritis. While for gonorrhea, it is for 1 day to 5 days. So in gonorrhea, the incubation period is very short, but in non-gonococcal urethritis, incubation period is very large. It varies from 1 week to 6 weeks. Now, the smear shows the greater than 5 pus cells per oil immersion field, but no gram-negative diplococci. No gram-negative diplococci. So that was the thing which was asked in the question, and it shows positive leukocyte estrus test in the first void sample. The syndromic management says that all cases of urethritis in syndromic management, you should treat for chlamydia also. So any urethritis, you treat for gonococcal and non-gonococcal in syndromic management. So this is the comparison of gonococcal urethritis with non-gonococcal urethritis, wherein in gonococcal urethritis you will see positive diplococci in the polymorphonuclear cells, while in non-gonococcal urethritis there will be no diplococci in polymorphonuclear cells. Then coming to the distinguishing features between the two, gonococcal and non-gonococcal urethritis, what is the distinguishing feature? In gonococcal urethritis, the symptoms are more severe, while it is less severe in non-gonococcal urethritis. Incidence is around 78% for gonococcal urethritis. It is more common, while non-gonococcal is less common. It is around 38%. Now, the discharge will be profuse, purulent and greenish yellow. Profuse, purulent and greenish yellow in gonococcal urethritis, while it will be mucoid or mucopurulent in non-gonococcal urethritis. The sensation will be intense burning sensation in gonococcal urethritis, while it will be a smarting feeling in non-gonococcal urethritis. Onset will be abrupt for gonococcal, while it will be insidious for non-gonococcal. Incubation period, as I told you, it is 1 to 5 days for gonococcal and 1 to 5 weeks for non-gonococcal. Constitutional symptoms may be present in gonococcal, while they may be absent in non-gonococcal. And lymph nodes, they are present in gonococcal and they are absent in non-gonococcal urethritis. So anything which is more severe goes in favor of gonococcal urethritis, and less severe goes in favor of non-gonococcal urethritis. So gonococcal urethritis is more common than non-gonococcal urethritis. Clear? Now we move on to next question. Which of the following is a bacterial infection of the skin? You are having four choices. You have to tell me which of the following is a bacterial infection of the skin. Your choices are Pyoderma gangrenosum, Pemphigus neonatorum, Impetigo herpetiformis and Ichthyma contagiosum. Yes, lymph nodes may be absent in non-gonococcal urethritis. Yes, what's the answer of this question? Question number 2, which of the following is a bacterial infection of the skin? I want all of you to be right for this question. But I am afraid no one has given me the correct answer. Not even a single person has given me the correct answer for this question. All have written 1, 3, 4, but the correct answer is 2. The choice 2 is correct answer. I have asked about the bacterial infection of the skin. Pemphigus neonatorum is also called as bullous impetigo. You should know what are the misnomers in dermatology. I am afraid all of you are wrong. So, coming to the discussion part, Pemphigus neonatorum is other name of bullous impetigo and it is caused by Staphylococcus aureus. Pyoderma gangrenosum, it is a neutrophilic dermatosis characterized by chronic, recurrent, very painful ulcer with undermined borders, usually found in the lower limbs, and it is associated with inflammatory bowel disease. So pyoderma gangrenosum is a misnomer. Neither there is pyoderma nor there is gangrene. It is a neutrophilic dermatosis characterized by very large ulcers, usually over the lower limbs. So it is a misnomer. Impetigo herpetiformis, it is the other name for pustular psoriasis of pregnancy that everyone should know. Impetigo herpetiformis is the other name for pustular psoriasis of pregnancy, and the drug of choice in these cases are steroids. And ichthyma contagiosum, remember ichthyma is a bacterial infection, but ichthyma contagiosum is a viral infection. It is a contagious pustular dermatitis caused by parapox virus. Ichthyma, don't be misled by the first term. Ichthyma itself, if the choice is there as ichthyma, it is a bacterial infection. But ichthyma contagiosum, it is a viral infection caused by parapox virus. So this is bullous impetigo or your pemphigus neonatorum. Bullous impetigo or your pemphigus neonatorum. This is pyoderma gangrenosum. Neither there is pyoderma nor there is gangrene. So this is pyoderma gangrenosum. It is a misnomer. It is a neutrophilic dermatosis and there is no definite cause for it. This is impetigo herpetiformis. Impetigo or pustular psoriasis of pregnancy. This is impetigo herpetiformis. And this is ichthyma contagiosum. Your viral infection. So ichthyma contagiosum is a viral infection. And ichthyma is a bacterial infection. Clear? Then coming to the diseases caused by Staphylococcus aureus. The Staphylococcus aureus can infect previously normal skin due to production of coagulase. The diseases are superficial folliculitis, deep folliculitis, furuncle, carbuncle, bullous impetigo, botrymycosis, and these last two are toxin mediated. These are staphylococcal scalded skin syndrome and toxic shock syndrome. So these are toxin mediated. Last two one are toxin mediated. So you should know diseases caused by Staph aureus. While the diseases caused by streptococci, which requires previously damaged skin, is impetigo contagiosa, erysipelas, acute lymphangitis, and necrotizing fasciitis. So these are diseases produced by streptococci. Now coming to question number 3, in which of the following condition does acantholysis resembles a dilapidated brick wall? Your choices are pemphigus vulgaris, pemphigus foliaceus, Hailey-Hailey disease, and Darius disease. Come on, you should answer it correctly, all of you. Well, nobody wants to answer it. Chalo, 3, of you have dilapidated brick wall appearance. That is very much characteristic. Nobody should forget this term. And first three, they were right. So this is the characteristic feature. This is a characteristic feature of Hailey-Hailey disease. So otherwise, last two, they have given me the wrong answer. So Hailey-Hailey disease is the correct answer. So Hailey-Hailey disease, also called as familial chronic benign pemphigus. Familial FCBP, familial chronic benign pemphigus. It is an autosomal dominant disorder with blistering. It is characterized by minute vesicles, erosions, crusting and fissures in the intertriginous area, mainly in the axillary area and in the inguinal area. Minute vesicles, erosion, crusting and fissuring in the intertriginous area. And this is due to mutation in ATP2C1 gene encoding this Circa's calcium channel ATPase. So there is malformation of desmosome causing acantholysis. This is due to malformation of desmosome causing acantholysis, and this is not an autoimmune disorder and no autoantibodies. So remember, Hailey-Hailey disease is a condition where it is not an autoimmune disorder and there is no autoantibodies. So there is no point in asking for a direct immunofluorescence to be positive. So the question may be asked in this way: in which of the following condition immunofluorescence will be negative? So Hailey-Hailey disease is one of them in which the immunofluorescence will be negative. So this is due to malformation of desmosomes which causes acantholysis. Histology shows widespread loss of cohesion between the suprabasal keratinocyte. It is suprabasal keratinocyte. Partial acantholysis. Separated keratinocytes are still partially attached. And this gives rise to this dilapidated brick wall appearance. Suprabasal keratinocytes, they are still partially attached to adjacent keratinocytes. So they give a histological picture of dilapidated brick wall appearance. So, as I have told you, the DIF will be negative, direct immunofluorescence will be negative. So, there is no, since it is not an autoimmune disorder, no autoantibodies, so no point in DIF to be positive. Remember, Hailey-Hailey disease, DIF will be always be negative. Other conditions where DIF will be negative is epidermolysis bullosa. So it is another condition where the DIF will be negative, except epidermolysis bullosa acquisita. So all epidermolysis bullosa DIF will be negative. Various differential diagnosis, they are candidiasis, frictional dermatitis and inverse psoriasis. Since the location of the lesions is in the intertriginous area, the differential diagnosis can be candidiasis, frictional dermatitis and inverse psoriasis. This is somewhat dilapidated brick wall appearance, wherein suprabasal keratinocytes, they are partially attached to each other. Question number 4. Which of the following will not commonly present as shown in the image below? Is it trichophyton, microsporum, aspergillus and epidermophyton? Which of the following will not commonly present as shown in the image below? While only two are answering, where are others? Well, all of you are right. There can be two answers to this question. The most probable answer is epidermophyton, but even aspergillus can be a positive answer. So epidermophyton characteristically do not involve the hair. So it is a picture of tinea capitis, the scarring alopecia due to tinea capitis and epidermophyton, there is no hair involvement. So dermatophytosis, it is caused by three genera. Trichophyton, the first one, it infects skin, hair, nail, everything it infects, skin, hair, nail. The species include Trichophyton rubrum, most common, then Trichophyton mantegrophyte, Trichophyton tonsurans, Trichophyton scholini, and Trichophyton violaceum. So these are the species. In case species here are Microsporum gypseum, Microsporum canis, and Microsporum catis. While epidermophyton, as all of you have told me correctly, there is no hair involvement with epidermophyton, and only species which affects in this genus is epidermophyton floccosum. So there is no point in any hair involvement in epidermophyton species. Now, question number 6. The dose of oral ivermectin is, it is either 100 mg per kg body weight, 100 microgram per kg body weight, 200 microgram per kg body weight, 50 microgram per kg body weight, or 400 microgram per kg body weight. Where you use oral ivermectin, in which condition it is used? Yes, where are others? It is an important multiple choice question. I think 3 or 4 times I have seen this question in examination. Yes, Indrani, you are right. It is used in scabies. But what is the dose? Yes, now all of you are right. It is used in scabies. But what is the dose? Only one person has given me the correct answer. And the full marks goes to Aishwarya R. It is 200 microgram per kg body weight. So the dose of oral ivermectin is 200 microgram per kg body weight. So it is, ivermectin is a macrocyclic lactone GABA agonist. It is to be taken empty stomach. Peak level is after 4 hours. Dose is 200 microgram per kg body weight. It is usually given in 2 doses, 2 weeks apart. Mr. Solanki is also right, 200. It is the correct answer. Now coming to next question. Incubation of period of scabies in reinfection is. Incubation period of scabies in reinfection is. Your choices are 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, and none of the above. Yes, what's the answer? Incubation period of scabies in cases of reinfection. Well, nobody else knows the answer. Those who have answered, they have given me the wrong answer. See, remember, I have asked for reinfection, not a primary infection. For reinfection, there is no incubation period. So none of these is the right answer. For reinfection, there is no incubation period. So none of these is the right answer. So scabies, also called as water washed disease, water wash disease. It is caused by adult female Sarcoptes cabae. Normal individual contains only 10 to 14 of them in number. It is characterized by burrows, which is seen in the stratum corneum. Transmission is by close physical contact of at least 15 to 20 minutes is required of close physical contact. Indirect spread by bedding and clothing is unlikely. Outside host mite survives for 36 hours, egg survives for 10 days. Mite avoids area of high number of pilosebaceous units. So, scabies is not seen in the areas where there are more number of pilosebaceous units. And incubation period, it is 3 to 4 weeks for a primary infection. And it is absent in previously infected individuals. Can it? Yes, why not? It can be, the patient can go, can get reinfected even after treatment. Mr. Divya Prakash Singh Solanki, this is called as ping pong infection. If you treat one patient and don't treat the other family member, the treated patient will again get the infection from that untreated patient. So am I clear? So this is just to show you how a scabies might look like. This is scabies mite. This is a burrow. Burrow are seen in stratum corneum. This is again a multiple choice question. Burrow are seen in stratum corneum. Then what are the three important cardinal signs of scabies? They are night aggravation of itching, involvement of family members, and demonstration of mite. Night aggravation of itching, involvement of family members, and demonstration of mite. These are three cardinal signs of scabies, and all of these has to be positive to make a complete diagnosis. Burrows are 3 to 15 mm, wavy, dirty looking in stratum corneum, ending in a papule or vesicle. So burrows are seen in stratum corneum. Now coming to question number 8. Which of the following is not seen in pityriasis rubra pilaris? Your choices are salmon colored dry scaly patch, island of pairing, herald patch, and nutmeg greater papules. Which of the following is not seen in pityriasis rubra pilaris? So pityriasis rubra pilaris is a papulosquamous disorder. Which of the following is not seen? And where you see, all of you are right, it is the herald patch which is not seen in pityriasis rubra pilaris. And where this herald patch is seen, in which condition? The herald patch is seen in which condition? What rosea? It is not just rosea. Yes, it is pityriasis rosea. Pityriasis rosea, you see a herald patch. So, coming to the discussion of pityriasis rubra pilaris, it is PRP. My mnemonic is P for palmoplantar keratoderma or palmoplantar sandal. Then R for red color scaly plaques with island of sparing. And third P is perifollicular rough red papule forming nutmeg greater. So this is the three important clinical presentation as well as the PRP, the pityriasis rubra pilaris is concerned. So this is the salmon color patch with island of sparing. This is the salmon red color patch with island of sparing. This is palmoplantar keratoderma. PRP sandal in Petriasis rubra pilaris. This is perifollicular rough red papules. Perifollicular rough red papules. So this is perifollicular rough red papules. And last is, this is the red color patches with island of sparing. This is island of sparing in Petriasis rubra pilaris. Question number 9. The histopathology picture is suggestive of. You are looking at a histological picture. You should tell me what is the diagnosis, whether it is psoriasis, leishmaniasis, mycosis fungoides or pemphigus vulgaris. The histological picture is suggestive of psoriasis, leishmaniasis, mycosis fungoides, pemphigus vulgaris. Only one correct answer till now. So this picture, it is a repeated question from AIIMS. This picture itself is repeated. The same picture was given in examination. And I am afraid most of you are wrong. Only two have given me the correct answer. So it is a clinical picture, histological picture of pemphigus vulgaris. Can't you see this suprabasal cleft? Suprabasal cleft. Even when I saw it for the first time, this camel foot rataringes, it was looking like psoriasis vulgaris. But the diagnosis is this suprabasal clefting. It is a histological picture of pemphigus vulgaris. So pemphigus vulgaris is a potential life-threatening disease. Any stratified squamous epithelia can be affected. It is due to IgG against desmoglein 3 causing acantholysis. Usually affects face, scalp, neck, axillae, groins and trunk. From center it spreads to periphery, that is the centripetal distribution. Characterized by flaccid bullae, large thin walled bullae on normal skin. So remember, the bullae appear, they arise on normal skin, because in bullous pemphigoid they arise on urticarial skin. So bullae in pemphigus vulgaris, they arise on normal skin. They erode to form ulcer, which are multiple, progressive and painful. Ulcers are multiple, progressive and painful. There is little tendency to heal. They have grayish necrotic slough. Nikolsky sign is positive and Bulla spread sign is positive. So this is a blister of pemphigus vulgaris, the flaccid blister, and this is the ulcer. This is the ulcer of pemphigus vulgaris. So Nikolsky sign, what is this Nikolsky sign? So Nikolsky sign is extend the area of sloughing by applying gentle lateral pressure on skin surface at apparently uninvolved side. So you apply pressure or torsional pressure at normal skin surrounding the blister. So there will be sloughing of the normal skin also. That is a Nikolsky sign. So that is positive in staphylococcal scalded skin syndrome and pemphigus vulgaris. So you apply a torsional pressure on the apparently normal skin, and there will be formation of blister. So that is a Nikolsky sign. The bulla spread sign, also called as Espo-Hansen sign. Espo-Hansen sign, you have, that is lateral extension of bulla with pressure. So you apply pressure at the edge of bulla, and there will be a lateral extension of that bulla. So this is Espo-Hansen's sign in Pemphigus vulgaris. Then in brief, little tendency to heal, and other mucosas are also involved in severe cases. So mucosal lesions are seen in around 70% of the patients. So this is the oral manifestation of pemphigus vulgaris, the ulceration of the oral mucosa. The ulceration of the oral mucosa, it is the oral manifestation of pemphigus vulgaris. Investigations for pemphigus vulgaris, you make a Zang smear, you will see acantholytic cells. Skin biopsy will show suprabasal cleavage having a row of tombstone appearance. That is the characteristic term used, row of tombstone appearance. Direct immunofluorescence will show IgG and C3 in the intracellular spaces, giving a fishnet pattern. And IAF, indirect immunofluorescence, will show circulating IgG and C3. So this is histology of pemphigus. This is supra basal cleft, and here it is the keratinocyte giving a row of tombstone appearance. Here it is the DIF shows fishnet pattern. So coming to the last question of today's discussion, direct immunofluorescence will be negative in all except. In all of the following condition, the direct immunofluorescence will be negative except. I think I have answered this question in the earlier slides. Direct immunofluorescence will be negative in all except. I have answered it in the earlier slide, so correct answer is epidermolysis bullosa acquisita. So it is the choice 2, epidermolysis bullosa acquisita, the direct immunofluorescence will be positive. So the immunofluorescence will be positive in epidermolysis bullosa acquisita due to presence of anti-collagen 7 antibodies. So we do a technique called as salt split technique. So we know there are many conditions in which you will see a linear deposition along the basement membrane zone. There are very many conditions in which you will see a linear pattern of immunoglobulins at the basement membrane zone. Then how to distinguish between those conditions? So for that conditions, we do a salt split technique, means we split the basement membrane. We split the basement membrane on which this immunoglobulins are deposited. So we make a split in the basement membrane so that those antibodies which localize towards the roof side, they get distinguished from those conditions in which antibodies are localized towards the floor side. So we make a split in the basement membrane, and antibodies, the diseases, they are further distinguished by their pattern. Some they are localized towards the roof of that split, and some they are localized towards the floor. So it is to distinguish between subepidermal blistering diseases having similar DIF pattern. Incubation of patient skin in 1 molar sodium chloride produces a split at basement membrane at the level of lamina lucida. You know, in my plus classes, I have told you that basement membrane zone has two layers, lamina lucida and lamina densa. So with salt split technique, we make a split at the level of lamina lucida. DIF, direct immunofluorescence of bullous pemphigoid, it localizes towards the roof and floor, because bullous pemphigoid has many antigens, BPAG1, BPAG2, so it localized towards the floor as well as the roof. Well, the DIF of epidermolysis bullosa acquisita localized towards the floor. So otherwise, without salt split technique, both of them, they look like a linear pattern of deposition of immunoglobulins at the basement membrane. So this salt split technique is utilized to distinguish between various diseases having same DIF pattern. And DIF will be negative in, remember, these are the conditions in which the DIF will be negative. It is epidermolysis bullosa simplex, junctional epidermolysis bullosa, then dystrophic epidermolysis bullosa, Hailey-Hailey disease and Darius disease. These are the conditions in which direct immunofluorescence will be negative. So remember, in bullous disorder, these are the five conditions in which there will be no direct immunofluorescence finding. Epidermolysis bullosa simplex, junctional epidermolysis bullosa, dystrophic epidermolysis bullosa, Hailey-Hailey disease and Darius disease. So you should remember these five conditions. So with this, I think we have come to an end of the today's class, of today's YouTube session of multiple choice questions in dermatology. I'll come once again tomorrow same time with some more multiple choice questions in dermatology. So for your information's sake, an academy is starting a foundation course for NEET PG 2021, and there will be a sessions in all the subjects. So it will be beneficial for you, those who are aspirants for NEET PG 2021. And also there is integrated batch for NEET PG for central nervous system, and this is for NIMHANS entrance in March 2020. So these are the two batches which are going on for your further NEET PG 2021 and NIMHANS March 2020. These are few subscription rates. And this is my referral code, Dr. Avnish bar YT, if you want to join. So this is my referral code for, you will get some 10% discount with it. So that's all for today's session. With this, I end today's session, and hope you enjoyed the class, and thank you for patient listening. Thank you.